Hello everyone. Thank you once again for joining in this part two of this MeanStack webinar. So in this webinar, we'll be covering about like cloud deployment and CI/CD pipeline concepts. So let me share my screen. It started. Harshit, is my screen visible?
Yes, all good. Yeah.
Yeah. Hello everyone. So yeah, so in the last webinar we were discussing about like creating a simple inventory application using the MeanStack. I mean MongoDB, Express, Angular, and then Node.js. So in this video, in this webinar, we will be discussing about how we will be able to deploy this application in a cloud platform, and then like so that you can access outside your system also. For example, when you are developing the application, what happens, you will be able to access within your machine using the localhost address. But if in case you want someone else to access your application, what are the possible solutions we have? Either we need to expose our system through to internet, and then like we can, so that the user can will be able to access your application, or else we can push this code into a cloud, in cloud environment, which is offering infrastructure as service or software as service, so that from that place they will be able to access your website. So right now we are accessing this application from the local host. So let's say if I am in local host, you are sitting at a different computer in the world, and you want to access my website. So how do I give access to this? So I need to do something. I need to push it to a environment called cloud, where I will be able, where you will be able to access this application, and then do whatever you want to do with it. So right now we have multiple solutions for it. So when you are going for a cloud deployment, there are multiple solutions. So let's go with like a very initial solution, what people are doing. So initially your system will be connected to an internet. So locally you will be sitting at, your system will be sitting at one place, and your system will get connected to internet. You will have an IP address. Let's say if you go to my website, like what is my IP address.com. So you will find what is the IP address. So then that is the public IP address, which with that anyone can will be able to access your system. So if the server is up and running in your system, so the using that IP address, they will be able to access your website. But you may be in a situation that you cannot have a working internet connectivity every time, and your system needs to be on all the time. So in that time only, we have come up with a solution called cloud deployment, where you can push the code to any machines running in a cloud. Cloud is nothing but a remote machine which is at some server, which is given as a service to you, so that you are accessing that instances remotely. So let's say we take an AWS instance. You are procuring an EC2 machine from Amazon AWS, and you are pushing your code to AWS instance. Then from that AWS instance, you can run your server. The server can be up and running 24/7. Then they will be able to access it. But even if you push it to AWS EC2 instance, what happens? You will be getting an IP address. But if in case you want to have a your website address, like for example, mywebsite.com, if that should link to your address, then we need to configure something called a DNS, which you can procure from many of the hosters like GoDaddy. There are many hosting providers. From there, you need to procure an URL. And typing that URL, so the DNS system will map your URL to an IP address. Then by typing that IP address, let's say mywebsite.com, they will be able to see your application. Right now, for developers like us who want to do a test and trial and then deploy using some free resources and all, Heroku is a very good platform to do all kind of stuff. So Heroku will allows you to create any applications in cloud, like it can be like an API or Angular application. So whatever you would like to do, you could do with Heroku. So now we will cover in the detail about like how we will be able to deploy to Heroku, and then what are the steps involved in it. So right now, if you want to create any application in Heroku, after signing up for the Heroku after signing up for the Heroku account, you can click on like creating new application. Then we need to give a new application name here and then just create app. The application will get created. Since I have already exhausted my free tier limit, I won't be able to create a new app. So once you created a new app, this is how the structure would look like. So it has a lot of settings involved in it. So we just need to know how to push, how after creating Heroku application, how to push code into it. Because Heroku is running a remote server, now we need to push the code into that so that we will be able to access, we will be able to run our application. For example, I have created, hosted my API in this application called a TCINV API. If I open that application, API V1 inventories. So when I access this API, now it's trying to access that application running inside the Heroku machine. So very first time, if the Heroku instance is sleeping, it may take some time to get the response. After that, it should be faster. So now we are getting some response from the API, like the list of quantities listed over there. So what I have done here is that whichever API which I was running locally earlier, like by doing the npm start, now the same code has been pushed into a remote machine inside Heroku. And from there, the server is started. Now you are getting the response from that particular server. So all those configurations need to be taken care of. For example, like what is the MongoDB URL? So all these things we will configure using the configuration variables. So it's more or less, it's similar. Instead of running inside your machine, you are running inside a machine in the cloud. So that is why we call it as cloud deployment. So because we don't know from which machine this is running. Without running in some server, you are not going to get this output. So it is running in some machine in a remote, in somewhere in the world. So this is why it's called cloud, and we are deploying this application in the cloud used in the Heroku. So now we are getting responses from Heroku for this inventories endpoint. You can check this here. Now, similarly, we need to deploy our front-end application also into Heroku. See, for an application, for an UI to work, we need both the API and then the UI to be hosted in the remote. It cannot be like you are running API locally and then like you are hosting the application in some other, like UI, it cannot be like UI is hosted in, API is hosted in locally and UI is hosted in like cloud. That cannot be possible because when UI is hosted in cloud, it needs to contact the API server. So the API server also should be available in an IP address or like in a URL like this, Heroku URL, whatever it is. So it needs to be accessible. So we need to push both API and application to Heroku. Then we'll be able to access it. So now what I have done, I have deployed both of our code into Heroku, that UI and then API. Then I will explain how I have done that. So there are multiple ways to push the code into Heroku. If you look at, one second. So using the Heroku CLI, if you see the list, if you check the steps here, how to do it. So they will mention here, like if you are installing the Heroku CLI, you just need to push it to a Git repository maintained by Heroku. Then when you push that, then it automatically makes the deployment based on whatever code we have written. It will deploy it automatically and makes the application available. So right now we could see the application is deployed in Heroku and it's served in HTTPS. So this is the output coming from our API. So we can check the responses here, the salt, sugar, and all these things. This is coming from our API. So once this is coming from our API, and we can check all the functionalities listed over here, like adding the inventories, getting the list of inventories, consume inventory. All the functionalities are same, which we have discussed in the previous webinar. In this here, now since we have deployed to Heroku, you can access it from anywhere. So if you'd like to see this in your system, I will share that link in the chat. Just a second. Not all panelist attendees. Yeah. So how about the databases also in cloud? Yes, correct. Because since we are your post hosting our UI and API in the cloud, in the UI and API remotely, the database also needs to be present in the cloud, or it should be in any server which is accessible from a public internet. So for example, we are taking a sandbox from MongoDB Atlas. So this will give us access to, this will ensure that we can access it from anywhere. So if I am running locally the MongoDB, I will not be able to access outside my machine, or I need to make it available and my system needs to be up and running every time. Since I want to make it available 24/7, I can go to any service provider who is giving me MongoDB database as a service, like for example MongoDB Atlas or from Azure or like any instances. If there are multiple service providers who give the database as a service, so we can take database from them and then use it. Or else what you could do, you could take one machine in AWS, install MongoDB over there, and then start a MongoDB server and make it accessible from the outside the world also. So there are multiple opportunities to multiple ways to host the database in cloud also. So here, this is the database which we have for our application in MongoDB Atlas. I will show you the collections. So if you could check here, from the inventories collection, we have this list of items. So somebody's added the some entries like water. So you can see it here. It is already added in the database. Now, if I refresh this page, it should have appear here as well. So right now, so we don't have a loading indicator or skeleton loading here. That is why you are seeing some time difference between when after refreshing the page, it will take some time to fetch the data from API. So the improvements what we can do to this application is like you can put some loading indicator, or we can use something called skeleton loading. So skeleton loading is like a, one second. This is the more de facto standards nowadays. Skeleton loading API. So you could see how skeleton loading look like. For example, if you're opening like in youtube.com or something like that, you will see some lines. This is called skeleton. So skeleton loading is, instead of showing a circle loading indicator, people nowadays are preferred to use a skeleton loading indicator so that like the structure looks intact. And as soon as the data comes in, the skeleton loading will get replaced with the actual content. And the loading, the page layout will not change much. That is the benefit of using skeleton loading. So these are the improvements which you could do to this application. Any other question? Okay. So this is how, now we have deployed this first the database we have deployed in MongoDB Atlas. Then the API, and then this UI application we have deployed in Heroku, and both are accessible now. So now we have deployed in cloud. Then what's next? So initially, when we deploy to cloud, the steps used to be manual. For example, after doing everything, you need to make sure that you need to build your code and then push it to some server, make it available. So all these process were so tedious. So we were not getting much of time to focus on the quality development. In order to remove all those pain points, the people have come up with a concept called CICD. CI means continuous integration. C means continuous delivery. So what is this concept of CICD? So when we started software development, we were having some models like waterfall model. Now we are using a very advanced methods like agile methodology, where you plan the work in like iteration, story points. Within a week of something, we are going to deliver some short, small features. So the developments are happening very fast. So in this fast happening development, so we need to ensure that the deployments and then all these processes also automated, so the developers are not spending so much of time on ensuring the test cases are passing, and then deploying into cloud for testing on all these things. So that's when this thought process came in, and people started developing tools like Jenkins. And then, like, now we have cloud-based platforms, like even GitLab has its own CI/CD pipeline, Circle CI. There are many CI/CD tools available now, which ensures that once you push your code into a version control, like a Git or Tortoise or any version control, from after that, we will write some steps to ensure that first, let's say you want to check whether there is any lint errors in your code or not. So you can run that step to ensure that the code, in that code, there is no lint error. Then the second step would be executing your unit test cases. If you have written any unit test cases, you can ensure that all the unit test cases pass before deploying your application. Then the third step would be to build your application. So if it is an UI application, we need to build the code. So that we have a process called building, which will create the JavaScript bundle, single HTML, JS file. So all these building steps will take place. After that, you need to deploy. So a deployment has a lot of steps like this. So before you deploy your code into an application, into a cloud platform, there are multiple steps and then checks involved in it. So if you want to do all these things manually, it could take up a lot of your valuable time. Let's say your test case might be taking like 10-15 minutes of time to execute. So until that time, you may need to wait and check whether any test case failed or not. Is there any problem happening with the deployments? So your precious time could be lost doing all these things. So in order to avoid that, this concept has came in CI/CD, which can help you to overcome that. So what will happen in CI/CD, that we will cover in detail now, how to do it. So in every platform, every framework, they have different methods to do it. For example, in Jenkins, if you are creating a pipeline, you need to specify like, okay, so what is the first step? What is the second step? So you need to specify that in a different way. But in GitLab or CircleCI, every framework has a different way to specify what you need to do. Like how we have different programming languages, Java versus Python. A Java code cannot work in Python because you need to write it in the manner which it understands. So likewise, we need to write in a way every framework understands. Now we are going to look about how GitLab CI/CD pipeline works. So I will explain how to do a GitLab deployments in GitLab pipeline. So this is the GitLab CI file, which you are looking in my notepad, in my Visual Studio Code. So in order to execute CI/CD pipelines in GitLab, we need to create this file called gitlab.gitlab-cy.ml. So in this, you will specify what kind of steps you need to do once the commit is pushed to the repo. So once CI/CD pipeline is enabled, you will be able to check the status of it from this menu calls, from this menu option, CI/CD. Okay. Now before, if there is no CI/CD pipeline in this application, it will be empty. Once you push this .gitlab-cy.yml, then for every commit based on the conditions given here, for example, for master branch only, this particular pipeline should run. Then for master branch only, this pipeline will run and it will get deployed. So we will go step by step what is being done in this gitlab-cy.yml file. Before that, is there any questions on like what is CI/CD? Why CI/CD has come into picture? If you have any questions, then I will answer that. Okay, so next, let's move on to how to create this GitLab CI file, which is useful, which is used for our CI/CD pipeline in Heroku, GitLab. So here we are deploying our application to Heroku, correct? So we are deploying into Heroku application. To deploy into Heroku in an automated manner, we need something called API key. So when you go into your account, so there is something called Heroku API key, API key. So you need to, once you create your API key, you need to copy it and keep it in some notepad, because to deploy from an external application, you need to grant access to Heroku. So to grant access for external applications like this, they have an API key which will give access to deploy your code. So we need to copy this API key from here. Then you need to know what is the name of the application which you want to deploy. For example, I need to deploy this application called TCINV API. So now I need to know what is my API application name and what is my API key. If these two things are available, then deployment from GitLab to Heroku is very, very easy, because they already have some tool called DPL, which is, you can check about DPL as a deployment tool. It is created by Travis CI, but it can be used with GitLab CI/CD also. So this tool is very much helpful in deploying to Heroku. You just need to specify to which provider you need to deploy. I mean, Heroku or like any other cloud hosting platform, you need to just specify the provider and what is the application name and what is the API key. If you just specify it, it will deploy it. So this is the command which it will get executed when the deployment step is coming up. But before coming to that step, there are some set of steps that needs to be executed. Okay, so first one is image. So image is nothing but a machine, an instance where this application or code should run. So we were talking about Dockers and then like containers in the previous session. So here, just for insight, so when you want to create when you want to install an application into a server, so you can do it within a container also. I mean, within a machine which is put into a small container. So that container will have its own operating system where all these dependencies will get installed. So we will begin with an machine or an image. So let's how will you install an operating system? We will copy our Ubuntu ISO image or like Windows image into an operating system. Then we will install into our system hard disk, right? So similarly, so there will be a ISO image with the Node.js installed already. So what the system, the GitLab will do is that it will take that image, it will install into its own machine where all these steps are going to get executed. So first step, it is going to fetch an operating, it is going to fetch an image in which the Node.js is already installed. So most of the images are Ubuntu based, like it could be like CentOS or like, Linux based, it could be CentOS or it could be like Fedora or it could be like Ubuntu. So whatever OS it is, it will be a Linux based solution only. So from that image, it will take that image and it will start executing the steps. I mean the before script step first, because before executing any script, so there could be some pre-installation steps or something like the pre-installation checks. So you may need to install some basic dependencies or update the dependencies in the system before you install the actual application. So in order to execute this DPL command, you need to first install that DPL application into this Node.js image, no? So that is why in this before script section, first what they will do is that apt-get update. So in Linux, if you are a Linux user, you know when you do sudo apt-get update, all your system dependencies, all our application installed in your system will get updated to the latest version. Then after that, they are installing the Ruby. So the DPL is based on Ruby. So that's why we are first installing the Ruby in our machine. I mean, in the machine which is running this all this application. Then after installing the Ruby, then they are installing this tool DPL. So once this DPL is installed, then you will be able to execute this command. So if you have not installed the DPL before executing this command, then obviously the script will fail. That is why before executing the script itself, we are installing all the required dependencies for running this commands, whatever you are writing in the script. So what is called stages here? So like I was saying, there could be multiple stages while deploying an application. Let's say first step is to ensure that there is no lint errors in your application. Second step would be like executing your unit test cases from in your application. Then the third step would be like creating a production build for the application. And fourth step would be like, let's say, starting or stopping the server, database server. So there are a lot of, in a real life application, there could be a lot of steps that needs to be done when an application is deployed. So that all comes into multiple stages. But in our application, in this simple Heroku application, we are not checking anything. We are directly going to deployment step. But if you like, definitely you can do first stage, like ensure that there is no lint errors. Second step would be like executing the test command and ensure that there is no failures. Then the third step would be deployment in this simple application. But since we don't have any test cases and all, we are not doing any executing any test. But in a real life application, all these things could be present, like linting, testing, and all these stuff. So in the deployment, development is the stage which we have created. So in this stage, we are asking to execute this script. Well, the script is the command which we are mentioning here. Like the DPL is the tool which is used to deploy to Heroku. We just need to specify the provider, and we need to specify the name of the Heroku application and what is the API key needs to be used. Since we are using a variable here, we are using this dollar symbol to fetch that variable from the GitLab variable sections. So if you go to settings, CI/CD in the GitLab, we can see that there is something called Heroku variables. So since we cannot expose our credentials like Heroku API key in the GitLab code base, we will be setting that in the variable section here, so that it's not accessible to the other developers who don't need to know all these details. So only the DevOps team member who has the access to the environment, they will be setting all these variables. Not all other persons will know this. So that is why we will be using environmental variables here to fetch the API key and the application name. Then this one single line will take care of the deployment. So let's see how this deployment logs look like in Heroku. So I have opened a pipeline here. I mean the CI/CD pipelines. So there you can see there are two pipelines. So first time the pipeline actually failed because I made a mistake in the code that I didn't specify a variable in it. So let's check what is actually happening. So now there are two pipelines. One is a past pipeline after fixing it. Before that it got failed. Now we will see why it got failed. In the pipeline, there could be multiple jobs. So all these things, so you're seeing the log of like, okay, actually what is happening. First, it will fetch from the node, and then I mean the node image, then in that it is executing all the commands which we have given here. For example, before executing the script, we have mentioned like it should run apt-get update, apt-get install Ruby. So all these steps will get executed. So once all these things are done, then it will start our deployment process. So the DPL itself will take care of executing all these steps. We don't need to worry about like, okay, well, actually what is happening. Since we have specified like, okay, what is the start command, it will take care of these things. So it has a lot of steps in it, like, okay, how it is executing it. So those things we don't need to bother. We just need to specify, okay, where I need to deploy, what is the application name, and what is the API key to access the Heroku. So once all this is done, it will start executing all the steps. So you could check here. So there is some error when it is running the build command. So when it is building, so there was some error. So that's why the build got failed and the job stopped. So now we know that there is something wrong with the deployment. I need to fix it. So once we fix it, then the deployment, the pipeline will run again. So now after I fixed and pushed a commit to this, you could see for this every new commit on the master, the pipeline will execute. So now I have pushed, after fixing the URL, I pushed a new commit. So now the build step, it's, there is no error in the build step. So it got succeeded and it get published also. Though after it published, now you are able to access it from the Heroku URL. So this is how the Heroku pipelines work. So in the pipeline, we just need to specify, in the CI/CD pipeline, we need to specify what all steps I need to do to deploy this into the cloud application. It could be Heroku, or it could be like Google Cloud, or it could be like Azure. So wherever you want to deploy, we need to specify what are the steps you need to do to execute. So for doing some of, to ease some of our work, there are some tools like this called like DPL. So there are some tools which will help us to do it much faster. So instead of writing like hundreds of lines to deploy your code into Heroku, they are just giving one single line, which that application will take care of to deploy it once you just specify the application name and the API key. And so this is the way you need to specify in GitLab how to deploy it to Heroku. So once this file is committed and pushed to it, then the pipelines will get started. So before that, there won't be any pipelines or no CI/CD will happen in the repository. But once it is added, the pipelines will get started. So once the pipeline is succeeded, you will see this green tick mark here saying that the pipeline is passed. If there is any, when there is a pipeline is running, you will see a blue indicator here saying that the pipeline is loading. If there is any issues, we can figure it out from the status symbol here itself. So that is one of the advantages of having like CI/CD status here. So now we have checked about like GitLab CI/CD pipeline here, but there are multiple solutions like Circle CI, Travis CI. So there are multiple CI/CD cloud platforms available. You could check it out at your leisure. Like whichever, there are every solution, every CI/CD providers has their pros and cons in the terms of pricing, in the terms of speed they are offering, but every framework has its own way to specify it. If you learn about GitLab CI/CD pipeline, the same commands will not work in Circle CI. You need to refer to their commands directory and specify in the same, in the way how they're expecting it. So there are multiple platforms available. You could choose whichever you would like to use and then like use it for CI/CD pipelines. We have demonstrated with GitLab CI/CD or CI file here. This is used for deploying from GitLab to Heroku. Thus, this GitLab file will not work in GitHub. It will not work because GitHub is different, GitLab is different. So we are using the inbuilt CI/CD pipeline of GitLab. So this will work only with GitLab alone. If you want to move your code to GitHub, then you need to look out for solutions like Circle CI or Travis CI and write configuration files according to the CI/CD pipeline which you choose. So this is how, so now what is happening? It is easing your work of writing any codes to deploy. Once you write this GitLab CI.yml file, then you don't need to touch it again. 100 times you push, 1000 times you push, it will take care of doing all the steps required for deploying your application into the server. So this is easing the work for the developers, isn't it? So that you can focus much on developing a, creating a quality code instead of like spending time on like fixing the deployment issues and things. Any questions? Yeah. GitLab is similar to Azure DevOps. Yes. So every platform have their own DevOps methods, like GitLab CI/CD pipelines, and then like as like I told, Circle CI, Travis CI. So every platform is similar. So they have all these same steps. See, the concept is the ideology behind CI/CD is same. So it needs to ease the work of developers so that you can integrate multiple work at the time when you want to integrate, and make the deployment pipeline easier so that you can focus more on actual development instead of spending time on these deployment, executing tests and stuff. So this is the overview of how to do CI/CD pipe, how to do CI/CD with GitLab, and what is the basics of CI/CD I have covered with you, and then the cloud deployment. Then I am good from my end. Then open to questions.
We have a question in Q&A. It's like, what are the differences between GitHub and GitLab?
One second. Okay, here Q&A. Okay. So what are the differences between GitHub and GitLab? So GitHub and GitLab, both are different providers of Git. So for example, Git, what is mean by Git? So Git is the protocol, like it's an open source version control system. So you can have Git in your local system also. For example, when you install Git locally, so this is a local version control. So if you want to do this same in a cloud, so you need to have someone offer that as a service. So GitHub and GitLab are two different providers who are giving this Git as a service. So Git is a version control, which they are offering as a service in cloud. So apart from GitHub and GitLab, we have software, we have also tools like AWS, we have something called Bitbucket, that is also implementation of Git, and AWS CodePipe, I think CodeCommit. So AWS CodeCommit, it is also a source control. It's also version control for Git. Version control like Git. So Git is just it's an open source software that can, it is offered as a service by both by GitLab and GitHub. So now GitHub is owned by Microsoft. They have acquired it. GitLab is a different service provider. Like how, let's say MongoDB is there, or like, let's take any application like AWS or like Azure or like Google Cloud. So they are all offering similar kind of services only, but it is there, it's a different company. Like you can buy a packet of milk from any Kirana store or like supermarket or wherever you want to purchase. So wherever they are offering, you can purchase. Similarly, Git is also a software, it's an open source version control software that is offered as a service to you from multiple providers. Okay. Any other questions? How is Dockerization enabled in the GitLab via pipeline? So nowadays, all the CI/CD pipelines use the Docker as the base. So when you look at this, we are creating the Docker Compose file itself, we were seeing that we just need to specify the image from where you would like to fetch it, right? So similarly, in the CI/CD pipeline also, you will specify which image from where you would like to fetch it. So this is by inherent, it's Dockerized. So we don't need to specify any Docker building commands here. So if you would like to deploy in a Docker system, that is different. You will create something called Docker file when you are deploying into some your own EC2 instance, and then you want to Dockerize it, it is different. But Heroku itself take care of all this Dockerization and then like hosting it. So we are just, see, when we are having like a capsuled version of something, we don't know how their internals work. There could be theories about like, okay, how they are doing it. It's like they have like a cluster of machines. They will Dockerize your code automatically and then push into one of the server and then host it for you. So they will take, GitLab is not doing any Dockerization. Only for deploying, running this pipeline, they are running inside the Dockerized machine. But once it is deployed to Heroku, that is their own instance, like remote instance. They could be running in like a Docker or like a real instance, or whatever is the architecture, it is up to them. So I hope I answered the question. Is there any follow-up on that, Robinson? Any other doubts you would like to ask? So you can also create the sandbox version for MongoDB using MongoDB Atlas. So it's free for sandbox versions. It's completely free. So instead of like fetching from other, initially there was something called MLab and all. Now it is acquired by MongoDB itself. So that's why we will see only MongoDB Atlas in most of the places. There are many sandbox versions available for development and testing purposes. We can use it.
That's great, Sharad. Thanks for covering different concepts like skeleton loading. And I mean, yeah, we really need to know about these things. You have a question in the chat.
Yeah.
We can use CI for all type of applications like Node, Angular, React, Python, and Python applications. I think yes.
So, yeah. So whichever we can Dockerize it, definitely we can do CI/CD. Like for example, Angular, whatever front end application it is, the end product is same. It's going to be HTML, JavaScript, and then CSS. So this CI/CD is nothing but just building the code and then pushing it. So for every framework, every language which we have in market right now, I mean the familiar languages, Angular, React, Vue.js, Python, and all these things, we have CI/CD pipelines, we can do it. But if you are looking into something like Fortran or like any older ancient languages, that may not be possible. But for all latest languages being used, so CI/CD is possible.
Got it. We have another question in Q&A, Sharad. It's how do you connect MongoDB with Heroku? Maybe I have missed this part at the beginning. I think you showed that to us in the last webinar.
Yeah. So here I'm Heroku, for example, we are creating the API code. So in the API code, we will specify what is our MongoDB URL. So when we are developing locally, we just specify the local MongoDB URL. But once you have created in, for example, let's say MongoDB Atlas, so now you need to specify this particular address in the system, right? So either you need to specify it via environmental variables or you need to hard code in the code. So we generally don't hard code in the code. We specify it via environmental variables. So that is why we will first fetch from environment variable here, or we will use the default hard-coded one. So in the Heroku, in the settings tab, we have something called configuration variables. So in the config variables, if you see here, I need to specify what is the MongoDB URL. So now in the MongoDB Atlas, if you say you want to connect, so it will, how you would like to connect, like with the Mongo shell or connect your native drivers or like MongoDB compass, that will specify how you need to create the MongoDB URL. Like it will tell you, okay, what is the, you need to specify your username and password here, and what is the database name. So then you just need to specify this particular URL in the Mongo as the MongoDB URL. So for localhost, it's simple, MongoDB localhost 27017. But when we are using a MongoDB cluster like this, you need to specify in the format which it is recommending. For example, here they are already giving the host name here, the talkscript.reom.mongodb.net. So we just need to copy this URL and then specify the parameters here, like username, password, and then the database. Then we should specify it here. So you could check it that I have specified in the configuration variable. So now what happens is that API will connect to this particular Mongo database instance. That the code what we have written, how it is connecting, it is already written the code. We are using Mongoose library to connect to our MongoDB. So in the Heroku, we just need to specify what is our MongoDB instance URL. Thank you everyone for joining.